Israel is constantly under attack. It can't afford to make big mistakes, and it makes many mistakes, but none of them are ones that Israel can afford to do. And so intelligence is key. It's very important. I'm an American that was raised in Israel. When I was 7 years old, my family moved to Israel. When I was 16 years old, I got a little brown envelope in the mail, and it was basically, you know, a summon for testing. Right. And so I still remember this so well. I walked into this massive room with lots of students and tiny little wooden pencils, and they just started testing us. And the room got smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller. And eventually they figured out what the hell to do with me, I guess. After a few interviews on my 18th birthday, they recruited me. I got a bunch of shots and I joined the military. And so I served in a small unit called 8200, which was an intelligence. And, you know, Israel is constantly under attack. It can't afford to make big mistakes, and it makes many mistakes, but none of them are ones that Israel can afford to do. And so intelligence is key. It's very important. Limited resources in Israel. And, you know, I feel like so much of what I learned in the Israeli military and intelligence has impacted the way I think today. It's such a gift what they had given me. I'm incredibly grateful, especially as an American. I was raised in Israel, but because I came with an American family, I felt very strongly American there. Coming back here to the United States with the gifts that Israel had given me during my military training, I felt compelled to at least employ them here in my country, in my nation, in the United States.
So what's happening today? Because there's a lot of conflict in Israel. This is the May of 2021, just for reference. What's happening today?
Well, about a week or so ago, violence erupted with the, of course, Hamas encouraging its citizens to fulfill their mission to try to annihilate Israel. They don't want Israel to exist whatsoever. I mean, they chant it all the time, from the ocean to the sea, Palestine will be free. And so they don't want any Israel whatsoever. They're not even attempting to hide it. And so they found a reason to ignite violence, and missiles have been launched into Israeli cities. And, you know, Israel, not only does Israel, in my opinion, have the right to defend itself, Israel has the obligation to defend its citizens. And so when Israel defends its citizens, and thankfully Israel has this incredible technology, the Iron Dome, where they're able to actually stop the rockets from landing into the Israeli cities midair, it's such a blessing to have that kind of technology. But some of the rockets do fall in. And then on top of it, many of the Palestinians and the terrorists involved in this recent eruption are running into Israel, into the cities, and causing all kinds of additional violent attacks, whether it's stabbing or driving with their cars through Israeli neighborhoods and restaurants. And so it's very hard. I mean, I remember living there during multiple intifadas, which is what we call those violent periods of times where the Palestinians would go in. It's very hard. It's not a conventional war. It's a war against citizens. Luckily for Israel, it has some ability to defend its citizens through technology, but it's the classic example of the fact that people in social media and around the world who don't understand the conflict look at it as if, well, Israel's able to defend itself and it's made more progress and it appears stronger. And therefore, if they appear stronger, they must be the ones who are actually the bad guys. The bad guys are not always the ones who are more successful and stronger. That is oftentimes not the case, but it's just the way we've taught our kids. Well, you know, I mean, it's classic Marxism, right? And it's just because Israel is strong and able to defend itself doesn't mean that they're the aggressor.